I don't really have much of an understanding about either of them, but I would like to first point out who I am so that there is not much of a confusion. First is that I am not a guru. You don't see a beard, so I am not. I don't have any wisdom, and whatever was there, I shaved it today morning. So I am not a wise man. I am not a Sadguru or Sri Sri to be talking about spirituality in the way they understand because they practice it. But yes, I think I know a bit of science. So I would start with what I understand and then try to connect you to the idea of spirituality from the perspective that science offers. So let me start by saying that science and spirituality are not different. They are one of the same thing. But in between, there is something else that is inserted. So I would like to point them out as, you know, say as people who practice them so that maybe you can relate to it better. So I would say that there is something called science that people like Richard Feynman practiced. It is a purest quest into understanding the nature of the universe. Then you have something like scientific religion. So I would say the latest heroine from Greta Thunberg qualifies for that scientific religion. Then there is something called religious science. I would put Sadhguru there as somebody who qualifies talking about there. And then spirituality. Spirituality, I don't think that it is easy to know who practices it because it is something far too deep and far too, you know, different than other three domains that we talked about. But let's start understanding what is common between science and spirituality. So as I did not really know what spirituality was, today I kind of looked it up, and thankfully, you know, Irfan Khan's interview or whatever it is I was watching, one interesting statement cropped up. He says, I was trying to connect to the wisdom of the cosmos. So I would say that is something that maybe is what, you know, we connect to as spirituality. And let's try to see what science does. So, you know, you look at the quest that spiritual people and scientists have. There's one very common understanding that both have, is that there is something beyond what we can see. See, we can see the reality around us. You know, it's tangible. I can see a table and I can see a phone and all this is there. But, you know, there is a suspicion that all of us have that there is something beyond this. Now, this suspicion is the key to both. You know, science and spirituality, and both of them start looking at the universe to try understanding, you know, what is the kind of possibility that are there which you can't see. Now, you know, you have to realize one thing, that when you start a quest like understanding universe, there are a couple of possibilities, there are a couple of logical possibilities that, you know, one is that you will never be able to understand it, another is that you will be able to understand it. So both these possibilities are kind of dead end. But there is one possibility that if you keep working hard and trying to understand it, you may understand it. So you look at science. Science is basically an internal quest, you know, under the presumption that you can understand the nature of the universe. When you look at real spirituality, that is also actually believing in the same idea that you can understand the nature of the universe. But this is where the, you know, both science and spirituality part company, because, you know, science says, okay, you know, let's keep looking at the universe, let's kind of, you know, really do the cause and effect relationship study using empirical evidences, and, you know, we will be able to somehow come to a point. But ultimate quest in the heart of every scientist is basically some kind of finding a unifying order, you know, that you will understand the entire universe in entirety. So that is a unifying order that science looks for. But spirituality is different. Spirituality, I would say spirituality, as I understand, you know, it is typically an oriental concept, not an occidental concept, you know. Science is basically a Western quest, and spirituality is maybe an Indian or Eastern quest of the same issue. But if you look at spirituality, there is a leap of faith being made. You know, spirituality presumes that there is the nature of universe is cognizable, and the idea is that, you know, the ultimate answers are found, and you have to find a way of life. Now, this is a bit of, you know, it's a very interesting thing that we need to understand. See, science is never designed to give you a way of life, because science doesn't bother that somebody who is pursuing science has to live. But spirituality is different. Spirituality has a bigger problem. It says that human beings have to live. And then that means that it's an applied branch of, philosophical quest that a lot of cultures have undertaken. And that is what makes it very interesting on its own. So, let's first look at the way science understands the universe. So then from there, we will be able to go to the, maybe oriental understanding of spirituality, because there is something that is now started making sense. So science is basically, science is also making some very big presumptions, which we are not noticing. We have not been very carefully looking at the science and questioning it. That's why greater thurbers are happening. But science is presuming something very amazingly counterintuitive. See, let's understand that we are on a speck of a planet on a completely nondescript kind of, solar system in the galactic scale. We are nobody, forget the universal scale. But we are making one amazing presumption in science that laws of the universe are same everywhere. So if you really look at the universe, we are getting to perceive incredibly insignificant amount of the universe. And we are basing our entire science on that little bit of information that we have. So we are basically making a leap of faith that is unimaginable. Because this universe is not enormous in just the three dimensions that we know, but the universe is also enormous in the fourth dimension of time. So we are trying to say that the laws of universe that we can see today are the laws of universe that, that 14, 15, 16, 17 billion years of life the universe have had over this enormous expanse of space it has. So it is a leap of faith, but we don't really doubt it, and we presume that those laws are same across this entire spectrum of universe. This obviously causes a problem, and this is the problem that we would have to come to understand one of the greatest limitations of Western science and the kind of confusion that it is causing. So basically, Western science comes from the way our brain works. So brain is basically constantly trying to figure out cause and effect relationships between things that happen around us. So we are looking at evidences, and those evidences lead us to kind of see that, certain things are happening because of certain things. And we call, form those as rules, and that is the birth of science as we know. But this entire process has this one limitation that, I would really like to again and again reiterate, is that the evidences that the science is working on are actually extremely insignificant and small. And, that is where some of the issues that are emerging today are, really pinned. Because you see the way science has discovered some of these cause and effect relationships, they are basically very problem centric. So science sees a problem, attacks it and solves it without realizing that that problem is being viewed from a very, very limited perspective. So I think in the last webinar also I tried mentioning it out. But see, when science sees an insect eating crop, science quickly finds a pesticide to kill it. So that's a cause and effect relationship science has understood. So science sees a bacterium causes an illness, it quickly finds a antibiotic to kill it. Now the problem with this is that both these episodes that science is observing are in a very, very small frame of time. So you look at, this is my very favorite example, but you have something called locust, swarms that are attacking crops today in Gujarat. See, so locusts have been around since a very long time, and there's a difference in Orient and Occidental, understanding of the universe comes very strongly by looking at how both these civilizations have responded to it. So when Britishers came to India and they saw locust eating the crop, they realized that these fatalist civilization of, these pagans don't understand that you have a problem, you solve it. So they quickly, started locust control mechanism, and then, people worked on pesticides and destroyed locust, and, they thought that that's a victory. Similarly, when they discovered bacteriums and the illnesses bacteria were causing, they instantly recognized that, they can be killed using antibiotics. Now, both these perceptions that, that they felt we are, you know, they were very proud of. We go deeper into them, you know, the locust issue that we understand. Then locust is not something, the swarms of locust are not just happening randomly. They are happening only in a very unique situation with the temperature and rain and all coming in perfect stellar alignment. And then there is a situation conducive when you have a locust swarm attack. But what it is doing is that it is eating massive amount of, you know, converting it into some kind of protein that is very critical for the desert ecosystem. So, frankly speaking, if you look at the Indian response to locust, it was catching a locust, tying a nadachidi around it, doing puja of it and letting it go. Because farmers, traditional farmers, realize that this maybe is part of some bigger game. Similarly, if you look at, you know, say oriental curative practices like Ayurveda, they are not curing an individual because they are not looking at illness as a problem. So the entire understanding of universe that Western society has is that universe is a problem to be solved. Okay, so that is the science. So science has this reality as a problem and science is constantly trying to solve it. Now we shift to, you know, some of the other discoveries science has been making. So one of the strangest things that science have discovered is that this universe is chaotic in nature. Now, you know, this is a very confusing concept, but what is this chaotic nature of the universe? Frankly, this universe is so complicated and so interwoven that if I quote the scientist who mentioned it, he said that there is a, you know, flapping of wings of butterfly in Central Park and there will be a storm in Brazil. So that is the kind of complexity that this universe has. So if you really understand, you know, what it means is that this reality is actually impossible to be predicted. And the more deeper we get into the modern physics, we start realizing that reality is not deterministic. You don't cause and effect relationships as we imagine them to be are not really working that way because everything is just too interwoven. So that is the nature of the reality that even science is cognizing. Now this is creating a bit of a problem because what is human intelligence? Human intelligence is basically a tool to predict. So what human intelligence does is that it looks at reality. But where does it look at the reality? It looks at reality here. We use our imagination. We model the reality. So the way we work on reality is that we extract it, we reduce it, we make it small enough to be processed. So that means that what we are working on is not actually the reality. You are working on a model of the reality, which is extremely reduced. Now, such a reduced model, is it dependable to understand the behavior of the universe? Can we really understand the universe using this brain and these senses that we have? You know, there is another bottleneck that we have to realize, that we have five senses. Now, if I show you a picture of, say, infrared picture of a snake, you have to realize the enormity of that because your senses are not capable of seeing in infrared. That means that God is not really bothered to give us senses that can allow us to perceive the entire reality. Our senses are actually so limited that we see a small spectrum of light and we hear just a small amount of, you know, small bandwidth of sound. But the human brain, you know, with the tools it has to access reality, is not supposed to be something so grand because we have very, very limited sensorial abilities to see the reality. So all this is now getting very complicated because it is telling us that human intelligence is not really a very, very great tool. And as its processing ability is also very low, we can't really process deep into reality. Okay, so we can't predict something far into the future. All of us know that we can't know. Na janu janki na the saware shu thavanu je. We don't even, God can't know what is going to happen today. And that is because of the chaotic nature of the universe. Now, what is the point of being armed with intelligence in a universe that is chaotic? So this is now becoming a biggest challenge that we have to surmount and try to figure out, you know, how it has been done in past. And that is when we'll move to spirituality. Because science has not really bothered to find a way of life, but humanity has. And humanity has done it by understanding the nature of the universe, or rather predicting the nature of the universe. So I'll set aside science now, you know, with this idea in the background that you can hold that Human intelligence is a very, very fecal tool. It's not really made for, deep processing of the reality, and there is an issue with it. So we can't really trust it. Now, can we trust spirituality? So what is spirituality? If I said what Irfan said, some kind of wisdom of the cosmos. So can we access that wisdom of the cosmos? So there is, one more dimension that we have to bring to this entire picture now is biology. Because human intelligence is what we have in our brains, but there is deeper intelligence that is available to us from a very different source. And that different source is biology, that is crunching the universe for almost 4 billion years now. So it knows the behavior of the universe and it has its own way of, understanding the universe. And that wisdom is already available in a very, very concise form to all of us, to all life forms on this planet. And that is the genetic codes that we all have. So what are these genetic codes? These genetic codes are basically, life's experimentation with the reality, its interaction with the reality and what your life could find that was worthy of retaining and, encapsulating, that is kept in our genetic code. And that genetic code also constructs kidney and it also constructs brain. So obviously it has a kind of, phenotypic contribution to make in terms of having given us the instinctive understanding about the reality. So when we are born also, we are kind of reality ready machines. So with that kind of biological wisdom that is already available to us, is that wisdom the intelligence of the universe or the wisdom of the cosmos that we are trying to talk about? No. What Oriental philosophers have done is something tremendously different. So we have to now come to how limited to Indian understanding of some of these spiritual concepts that we have, because they are maybe closer to my heart in terms of the grand intellectual contribution they have made to humanity, but is almost forgotten. Is that we go back to understanding the behavior of the universe and the presumptions that we made. I said that spirituality made some presumption about the nature of the universe. So just going back to that, unified law of reality that science is seeking, Indian philosophers came across two very, very interesting ideas. They have a great bearing in, how we would move to understanding spirituality, which is basically finding a way of life in this chaotic universe. So these two grand ideas that we have inherited culturally, they are basically Advaita and Dvaita. Now this is, these are concepts which are very, very strange. And as all of us are educated in the Western educational system, we are not really, connected to them. But I'll start with giving you a very strange understanding. So if I say, what is the actual translation of Agyana in English? Or what is the actual translation of knowledge in Sanskrit? You would presume that knowledge is Gyan and ignorance is Agyan. In reality, the Indian idea of Gyan is an antithesis of the Western idea of knowledge. So if I have to translate knowledge into Sanskrit, the translation is actually Agyan. Why? Because knowledge is about differentiating. You know something, that means you know it to be different. Then I can know that this is a phone or this is a bottle or something, because I can differentiate. That is my knowing. While actually speaking, as per the Indian understanding of reality, this differentiation is an illusion. There is no phone, there is no bottle, there is nothing. So as long as you have Agyana blinding you, you see the differences. But the day you actually get Gyan, then that these differences dissipate. So differences are basically cherished by the Western civilization as knowledge, and they are looked down upon by Indian civilization as illusion. Now this word illusion is also tricky, because some would translate it as Maya, but I would not get into so much of technicality behind all these Sanskrit words. Each of them are wonderful and worthy of half an hour of conversation. But what Dvaita and Advaita are talking about is something very fundamental about the nature of the universe. So what, there are two big factions and there are huge, you know, philosophical wars between them. But what Advaita saw was that there is nothing and that is everything. So, you know, one of the other word that, you know, is often mistranslated, misunderstood, that is the salvation in terms of Indian understanding. And the Buddhist word called Nirvana, that we prefer to kind of use it because moksha is actually very different, is something that gets translated into English, it becomes completely different. So actual translation of word Nirvana is blowing off of a candle. So, you know, Western science has this understanding of, you know, human spirit as a candle in the wind and, you know, fighting and, you know, it's the light of knowledge. What Oriental philosophy says that blow that candle. That light of knowledge is actually disallowing you. It is preventing you from, you know, embracing the whole darkness that this universe has. You know, your intelligence, your knowledge is actually the ignorance that is causing this. So Advaita proposes a universe where there is nothing. And Dvaita has a slightly different view, and that is also a very interesting take on the nature of reality. And that is that, no, this, there is a perceiver, and the fact that this entire drama has taken place, that means that there is a distinction. There are two. The universe and its perceiver are both real at certain level. So the fact that this entire thing exists in such a way, that means that this reality has a duality. So both these principles have something very strange to offer. One is saying that this reality is nothing, you know, it's an illusion. There is nothing actually out there. The minute you get the awareness about it, when you recognize it, everything ceases to exist. So how does it offer spirituality? How does it offer a way of life? How does it all work? Because it's sounding very maddening to imagine that, you know, there's nothing out there, or maybe just the Jeev and Shiv out there. But it is not actually as, you know, complicated as we can imagine it to be. So the biggest take that Indian civilization or Indian spirituality or the entire Oriental spirituality has to offer is that it looked at this possibility of reality having an solution, an answer, a nature. It did not accept the reality to be the mad reality that science may end up discovering. And that is why the Oriental way of dealing with reality is spirituality, and that is training of the perceiver, the human brain. So if you look at the, you know, the Oriental traditions, they are like meditation, yoga, all these are mind preparing technologies for that ultimate finding of the, you know, the nature of reality. So the minute you find the true nature of reality, what would happen? You know, so this is where the most important thing that, you know, around which the Indian understanding of life is, you know, organized, is that you would merge into it. Once you understand something, then you no longer need to exist. You are becoming part of it. And that is the real spiritual quest that you have. Now, this is, you know, this is something that is not just a, say, philosophy that is here and say. There is something strange, which is the theory of karma that we have as a civilization, that is deeply connected to this entire idea. So what is theory of karma? So actually speaking, it's not actually theory of karma, it is the technology of karma, because it looks at this universe from the perspective of, I would say, let's say, to imagine it, to make it easier to think about it, as a river. So there is a river flowing in a given direction, and every soul is swimming in that river. But each soul has a different ability to take decision. So basically, whatever you do in a river, you know, it's actually, there is, if you understand the mathematics of vector, is part of a lot of actions that are taking place all over the universe. So the understanding that Indian civilization brings is that this is a chaotic universe with massive amount of things happening, and that's why nobody can really know the outcome of any action. So this is the fundamental principle of the karma theory, which tells you that you should act but should not become owner of the fruits of your action, because it is impossible in a chaotic universe, as science has even figured out. Now, what does it mean if you are not owner of the fruits of your action? Why do you act? So the idea is that you act to slowly come in the perfect alignment with the flow of the karmic river. So once you, if you do that, obviously then you are no longer swimming, you are part of that river. And you know, there is a very practically worked out theory behind everything. So you know, there is a concept that is very uniquely Indian, and you know, that is of reincarnation. Now, not that I believe in it or not believe in it, but it's a very beautiful solution to this entire picture. So basically, by Indian understanding of life, there is nothing called death. You are continuously living. Only thing is that death is when there is an accounting taking place of all your karmas. So you are picked out of the river and you are replaced in the river in a different position based on all the activities that you have undertaken. So at the, you know, at the change of the life form, you know, you are basically becoming more or less aligned with the flow of the universe, and accordingly you are placed. So what this principle talks about is placing people in souls in different unis, and that is basically the level of free will available to an individual. So human beings have the highest level of free will, so that is expected to be, as per karma theory, the highest you know, position in terms of you know, having free will. And you are made responsible, the most responsible for your action, to align yourself with the flow of the harmonic flow of the river of karma. Now, you know, if you really look at the concept, it is very robust in terms of its logic, because it's a very, very well designed picture of reality that is fully, you know, answering all the questions that one would have. And it offers something that is very interesting, because it allows you to live life and find that, you know, what is the way you should be deciding. So if these are the concepts that we have for living life, we kind of now go to the idea of you know, spirituality that is prevailing. So you know, there is a big you know, fad out there. Spirituality has become a very popular pursuit for a lot of people, and obviously when there is a fad out there, it creates a demand, and obviously that demand creates lots and lots of, you know, sellers and buyers of a commodity called spirituality. So the problem that spirituality faces today is that it has got lots of agents, and each of these agents have their own idea of making you feel that you are now getting more spiritual with your understanding. But if you really understand spirituality as is, then it is a very personal quest. It is not a quest that, you know, somebody else can assist you beyond a point. So the way spirituality is currently interpreted, it is nothing but a, you know, it's a force fitting of an idea very alien to the Western science into the Western science module. So what maybe is the greatest tragedy of Indian spirituality as it existed for a very, very long period is that it is currently made to seek validation from a completely alien system of understanding universe. Now, the real way spirituality can be pursued is to keep it out of the bound of science, because science has its own way of understanding universe and it is going to go on its own way. But if Western civilization's understanding are going to be forced upon the Indian idea of spirituality, you are going to have a mix that is not serving purpose of either of it. So I don't think that I have covered either science or spirituality, but what I have covered, I think, is the conflict that is there in these two ways of, you know, living life, or, you know, living, experiencing reality. And I believe that this conflict is currently damaging both these great branches of understanding universe and maybe appreciating the beauty that is. Because if you really look at science, it has its own daring, bravery, because what science is there says that you know, this quest is wonderful. We are not worried about what we'll find at the end, but we are going to enjoy the journey. And that itself is a very, very beautiful way of living, provided that you can be that way. The unfortunate part with science is that human beings are not designed for it, and science is not designed for human beings, because science is all about being able to accept that you are continuously wrong. You are in a search. You have never found your objective. So you will never know when the end will come also in that kind of a story. And that is why, if you look at even the way Indian philosophers have classified various ways to become, to find liberation, Gyan Marga is the toughest, because it's a path to questioning things continuously. But yes, it is a wonderful path if you can appreciate this beautiful universe and all its complexity. Human life is actually extremely short. It's not really, it doesn't look that we are designed to appreciate this universe in its entirety, and we are here for a very, very short period. So science itself is a powerful enough tool, a spiritual tool to pursue and understand reality and enjoy life. But simultaneously, spirituality as Indian civilization and maybe even Chinese civilization has understood it to be, themselves are also adequate ways of life, because they have made leaps of faith which are fairly consistent. And frankly speaking, if you really look at the kind of way of life that spirituality can offer, I think it is far superior than the way of life that science can offer to most of the people. So I guess spirituality is something that is here to stay, and maybe, something that we should be appreciating and maybe developing it further. With what is happening around us currently, we are not really appreciating spirituality and, are now damaging it. It's an heritage that we are damaging. So I would feel that, there is something that has to be recognized by both sides, people who pursue science and spirituality, that both of these are valid branches of doing things, and both should be going on their own way. Now, I'll just bring a very little, very practical, aspect of this entire thing with context to what is bothering all of us right now. That is this epidemic. So, what is the spiritual or scientific take has to do with how epidemics are responded to? So let's understand that epidemic is a social phenomena. It is something that is not happening to an individual, it is happening to the entire society. And what epidemic brings to all of our attention is death. Now, that means that every civilization, depending on the concept of death it has, would be responding to the epidemic differently. If you look at the Western understanding of death, death is a problem. Death has to be solved. You have to find a way to prevent death as far as possible. If you look at the Indian understanding of death as it was in that karmic understanding of universe, death was just a point of transition. It was not a problem. You don't fight death. You don't really wage a war against death. So if you look at in Indian civilization of an era where these understandings were socially more prevalent, the response to epidemic could have been very different. It would not have been an all-out war, because we would not have feared the epidemic as something that is, that is a problem. So this is where, you have to start understanding that spirituality and science have something deeper to offer to civilizations. So every civilization has interacted with this universe. It has its own wisdom. And spirituality is the Indian wisdom. Is the way we have understood this universe, and the way we have started, we have realized that it has subtle, deeper, larger cycles that are not something that science is able to observe with its short-sightedness. So maybe science is here for a while, but if you really look at the long-term existence of humanity, spirituality is maybe something that is here for a far longer period. And maybe as long as spirituality would exist, humanity would. Science is no guarantee. We can have science and we would go extinct. But if we have spirituality, if we align ourselves with the harmony of the universe instead of fighting it, maybe there is a better future ahead. Okay, so with that, I think I'll close my talk. But if there are any questions, I would love to answer them. So if there's any question that I can look up, then I can try to answer them. I think I missed some questions in the beginning, in between. Okay, so I think Priyanshi has asked, what has made the shift of society from religion to spiritual? This is maybe, I don't think that I am really that great a person in understanding humanity. But yes, one of the point of worry that we have is this entity called religion. And this entity called religion, as I pointed out, is straddling between science and spirituality. It is something that is pulling both of these together and forcing them to convert. So actually speaking, what we see today as religion is a forced marriage between science and spirituality. So what we observe around us is that religion is not really contributing what it should be. It is not really helping humanity, because it is causing more problems, because it is bringing some kind of extreme fixation in those who are possessed by it. So if the shift has to be made, that society goes more spiritual, my personal feeling that it can come from science. Because science is in its very nature a very open-ended process, and people who engage with science automatically end up with spirituality by experiencing the grandeur of the reality, grandeur of the universe. So you read any great scientist who is working in the forefront, who is working on the frontiers of physics, or thinking about things from the scientific perspective, you always start sensing a deep spirituality rising from within. So there is a great possibility that spirituality is not accessible to all, but somebody who can really look at the universe with a very open-ended, open mind, and spirituality automatically arrives. So I guess if we preach science in its purest form to people, there will be a shift made from religion to spirituality. Okay, so I have somebody asking me the G question. So what is God in the context of spirituality? I don't know, we have 12 observers, but yes, I'll take this, maybe the grandest question of them all. What is God? In the context of spirituality, in the context of universe? So if I go back to the Oriental understanding of universe, it is not actually recognizing something called a God. So we have all these kind of very confusing words, which are Bhagavan, Dev, Ishwar. But when it comes to the ultimate nature of the reality, yes, the word Shiva is used, in the context of Jeev. But if you really look at spirituality as an understanding of the universe, then the very nature of the universe is God. By God, I believe you presume that, somebody who is governing everything, somebody who is in control of everything, somebody who is driving this reality. Then, actual translation of God will be Maya. Because as per the understanding of Indian Oriental spirituality, Maya is like an equation that you know, which causes this reality to appear. So I'll give you a slightly different example to understanding. So you can, all of us have studied, you know, mathematical equations which represent geometrical shapes. So when you draw a circle, where is the equation of that circle? It is nowhere there. But the circle itself represents the equation of that equation. So that means that, you know, what Indian philosophy recognizes as Maya is the causer of the reality as we see it. But Maya is not above the Shiva, the ultimate reality, the Brahma. And hence, you know, the word God, as the Western society understands, cannot be translated. But the nature of universe itself is the God, if you really understand spirituality. Okay, so I have the standard pragmatism arriving in terms of spirituality, the cause and the problem of hunger and the real life problem. So this is where, you know, I would really come into a slightly conflict zone, because, you know, there is one very apparent fact before all of us if you don't want to ignore it. Western civilization is built on science. And our civilization, if whatever is remaining of it, is not built on science, it is built on spirituality. And all of us want to go to America. Not me, but I believe large number of us want to go to America because they seem to be having a happier life. They seem to be doing a lot better with living than all of us. So then why am I so excited about spirituality, and why am I questioning science as a issue of solving problems? So, you know, I'll ask this one very strange question, which, you know, makes easier to understand in the modern context. So what is healthcare? Is healthcare solving problem of an individual, or is solving problem of the entire species? So, you know, there is very numerical, very tangible proof that allopathy offers us about its superiority. And that is that, you know, people live longer. People lived for the average lifespan before invention of antibiotics was in the 30s rather. In 1919, the world average age was 31 years. You were supposed to be dead by the time you are 30. And today it is 70. So it's a very tangible, concrete proof that allopathy has done wonders. It has extended the life of human beings. So it is offering a better life to human beings. But can we transcend this a level one above, up, and understand what this increase of population did to this planet? What this increase of life expectancy did to the web of life? And then you start realizing that, actually speaking, it was a very short-sighted decision to step out of the wisdom of life. So the problem with science is that it is looking here and now. It is unable to see the deeper picture. So the entire strength of spirituality is that it is trying to look beyond this here and now, and trying to sense the deeper patterns, the universal flow. So, you know, science may offer you, an individual, a great life, but, you know, that same great life would have a negative impact on the community around him, and then it would have a negative impact on the society around him, and then on the planet around him, and so forth. So, you know, the benefits of science are actually misleading illusions. At times you get caught in them because they are happening in your lifetime, while you are alive. But you get a deeper picture about humanity, about this ancient universe that we live in. Maybe you start realizing that science is just creating more and more and newer problems. It is not offering you any solution. So I guess that, you know, from immediate perspective, everybody would love to have the benefits of science. But there is time to now recognize these deeper patterns and transcend it. You know, if you continue with science, I'll again go back to the example of allopathy. Do you think allopathy would survive as is for next 50 years? No. Because we are no longer going to be, you know, we are living in a small golden period where we have won the war against pathogens. But that's a momentary, that's a battle won. The war is not going to be won. So this is how we have to start getting connected to the bigger picture. And the bigger picture is accessible when you talk about spirituality. And that is why, you know, it's comparing apple to oranges. But yes, I would rather take my oranges. Is there any other question? Okay, so there is a question that is very interesting, which I would love to attempt, is that can spirituality define living and non-living? Okay, so this is a question which I have tried attempting from a different biological perspective. But what is living and what is not living? So basically, you know, if there is one way of looking at this entire reality as information and living as an entity that is processing information. And non-living as an entity that is not processing information. So if you really look at spirituality, it is basically looking at this processing of information as an illusion. So it is questioning this fundamental idea of living and non-living. It is trying to say that both of them are concepts which belong to a different understanding of the universe. In reality, this universe has nothing called living and non-living because there is only one. It's kun faya kun. There is nothing else. Is there any other question or should I close it? Okay, so there is a very kind of technical question because basically there is a suggestion that, you know, in Maslow's hierarchy, spirituality and enlightenment comes last. So does it mean that our survival instincts put a lower value to spirituality? Okay, so, you know, if you really look at our survival instincts, neither science likes it nor spirituality likes it. But I love them because they come from, as I would like to say, from a very ancient wisdom of life on earth, crunching reality. So where does our survival instinct comes from? Our survival instinct comes from our DNA. And where does our DNA come from? DNA comes from interacting with the reality. So survival instincts are basically very reduced, you know, hardwired protocols that help us survive. But you have to understand that that is working on the probabilistic match. That means that what you have, survival instinct, is something that will work most of the time. And it will not really work all the time. Now the question that both science and spirituality are attempting are to find out an ultimate solution that works all the time. And that is why, you know, survival instincts and both science and spirituality are at loggerheads. So today you have a situation where our neocortical wisdom, our learned knowledge is something that we find to be conflicting with the instincts. But yes, if you really look at the instincts, there is a simpler way of looking at the karmic understanding that it has, you know, as something that decides the amount of free will that you have. So if you tie it all up, there is a nice philosophical picture that emerges that, you know, having more instincts means less free will. That means you are in the lower yoni. That means you are somewhere behind in the river of karma. And, you know, less of instincts and more free will, that means you are floating up ahead in the river of karma and the onus is upon you. So, you know, how instincts rate spirituality is not really important, but yes, they have a role to play in the way we survive. But if we follow them, maybe then you are not really as spiritual as it would be. You would be. So I guess it was a very weird subject and I'm very surprised that we still have 16 people on board, but I would close it now. And this time I'm going to, you know, save it, so maybe it can be uploaded and it can be viewed by the future viewers if anybody is interested. I've tried covering various very, very disjointed areas, and I don't think I'm that successful with it. I wish I had a different medium because I wanted to play some songs, but in future, you know, we have okay, so there is one guy who is trying bring the mathematics into it, and he's asking me, do you believe that universe is a program? Okay, so that's a very interesting way of looking at this universe, but I think I would like to do another session on it to see, you know, the way can universe be a simulation or not. But I think the audience that we have would get bored because it has more of scientific technicalities than anything else. So I think I would close it here. Thank you very much for whoever was here to be watching something so strange. And, you know, we can always do more of these whenever anybody wants. Thank you. Good night. Enjoy.